Good energy fills me. I feel the love. I know it's not me. It's from above. I'm overflowing. I feel the good. It's something on me strongly. If you feel me, everybody throw your hands up and say,
yeah.
I don't deserve it.
Don't deserve
it's
it.
It's just his place. Mm-hmm. I'm aerial surfing. Gone with the wind. His hand is on me. If you agree, can't explain it simply. Go ahead and throw your hands up. I woke up this morning.
Thank you, God.
To get it in. No, I'm not playing. This is my trend.
God bless you.
No, I'm not perfect. I wanna get it right. So I encourage my own self. Turn left, focus on my own shelf. Reach for the top, don't stop. Hands. Yeah.
God bless you. Come on in tonight. Sunday night, Bishop Amos Live, 6 o'clock.
I feel good. I'm so grateful. I feel good.
Anybody grateful tonight?
I'm so thankful. I feel good. Man, I'm so blessed. I feel good. Hands up. Hands.
God bless you, Sister Stevens. Good to see you. God bless you. Thanks as they come in. Sister Johnson, Sister Mary, God bless you. We appreciate each of you tonight. We're worshiping the Lord. It is Bishop Amos Live on Sunday night.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've got a lot planned for you this evening. But to kick us off with a really encouraging song, please welcome Charles Jenkins.
Y'all know I love Charles Jenkins, right?
It's been rough. It's been hard.
Sister Ross, God bless you.
Everything that I've been
love you so much.
It's been weighing on my heart.
Glad to see you tonight.
It's been tough. It almost tore me apart.
God bless you, old landmark and friends. Tonight we celebrate Jesus.
I'm gonna make it with friends and my God.
Change the channel. Encourage yourself.
Everything is all right. Everything is all right. Everything
that's
is
right.
All right. All right. All right. Everything
Charles
is
Jenkins.
Right. Everything is all right. Everything is all right.
Everything is all right.
All right. Everything is all right.
Somebody ought to say it. Everything is all right. I believe everything is all right. So glad to see you all tonight. First Sunday in June. Oh, half a year almost gone. What a mighty God we serve. For some of you, it's been rough, but look what God has done. Been tough, but you made it thus far. I don't believe he brought you this far to leave you now. Hallelujah, yes. Praying for the saints. Praying for Sister Gloria Smith's family, sickness in the family, death in the family, but God is able to live. Others that are traveling, we thank God for you. Gonna give God some glory and some praise.
Everything is all right. Everything is all right.
How many get the message? Everything is all right. If you believe it's all right, give God a praise.
Everything is all right. Everything is all right.
We trust trust God tonight. Cher, would you, that we're on? Share to your friends, to your loved ones. Well, God bless you tonight. I, too, believe everything is all right. Thank you, Pastor Charles Jenkins, and the very gifted man of God who has served the gospel community for many years. We thank God for all of you, his people, and for the blessing that maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. To the glory of God, we lift up the name of Jesus. We honor you, the officers of our great church, the deacons, the mothers, the missionaries, and all the people of God. We thank God that we are able to go into the Word of God one more time. Amen. Learn a little more. Talk about church and our community. Talk about the things that are happening in our world. Amen. So bless God as you come in. Bless God that he has brought you through some crises in your life, but you have survived it. Amen. The Lord has rewarded you in making you rich with his mercy and with his gift and with his strength. And so we honor God and we praise him for what he's doing in you. We thank God for how he's blessing you and opening doors, making a way for you. None like him anywhere. We serve an awesome God. Hallelujah. We serve a God who does all things well. Knows how to bless, knows how to open doors. He knows how to make a way. Share that we're on. Let your friends and loved ones know this. Mr. Famous Live is on. And tonight we're believing God for great things. We're praying for blessings. Praying that the Lord will strengthen and keep you. We serve an awesome God, so we greet him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, our Father, we honor you and we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for an opportunity to give you the glory, to lift you up and to bless your holy name. None like you anywhere. Your name is worthy. Your name is the only name that gives us healing, strength, and deliverance. We pray your blessing this day upon us as we discuss and enter into the word and look at the days in which we live. We pray for peace of mind, joy in our hearts and in our lives, and that your glory will prevail. Let your will be done, Lord. Let your will be done. And we'll praise you and magnify you for it. In Jesus' name, we thank God and say amen. You know our God is awesome. Come on, give him a praise. He's awesome. Savior of the whole world. Bless you. By his stripes we're healed.
My God is awesome. Today I am forgiven.
Today I am forgiven.
Praise his holy name.
Hallelujah.
Praise his holy name.
My God
is awesome.
Somebody say awesome.
Awesome.
Good to see you tonight. God bless you. As we serve an awesome God, we appreciate the blessings of God and what he's doing and how he's moving. I ask you to prepare yourself. We're going to talk just a little bit about the gifts, and we expect to have some of the prophets on again next Sunday night. But I wanted to set the table, set the stage for our discussions. We're going into the Word of the Lord in the book of Ephesians chapter 4. Amen. And if you will, as we go into Ephesians chapter 4, we're going to read verses 7 and read on through verse 14. 7 through 14. It sounds like a lot of verses, but it's not. It's not a whole lot. Amen. But some things you've heard, but I believe as we seek to understand the gifts that God has given and the offices that the Lord has instituted, I think we need to take some time to hear a little more about these so that when we encounter them, we will understand their work and their purpose. So in the book of Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 7 says, "But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore, he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now he that ascendeth, which is, but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. I think I'll stop there, but I want you to understand as we read this text, it is full of order for the church. It is full of understanding of offices that are given through by Jesus Christ, through his apostles, through his teachers, through the organizers of the faith, in order to sustain the church until the time that Jesus should come. I know it's amazing how people are so short-sighted, and they only want to see what they can see during their period of time. But isn't it amazing that God can inspire leaders and inspire writers, inspire men to write words that will guide us until the coming of the Lord? His word never fails. The things that are spoken are true, not just for one time, but for all time. And so what the writer is showing with us here is that God has given grace to everyone. Everybody has got something from being saved, from accepting Christ as your Lord and Savior. You received gifts. You received calling. You received purpose. And as empty as you might feel, I promise you, you've got something. In fact, what we all got, everybody doesn't get the same thing, but everybody got this. We got grace. Somebody say, thank God for grace. Thank God for grace, because without the grace of the Lord, we could not be saved. Without the grace of the Lord, we have nothing to merit his salvation. We have nothing to merit his love. It is the favor of God, his choice, his selection, to save all men who would be willing to accept Jesus as Lord. He has a plan. Nobody has to be lost. People say it's so unfair that God would choose this one to save and that one to lose. He doesn't choose anybody to lose. He sent Jesus that he could die once and for all men, that he could die once and to accommodate everyone who would call on his name. So you are given grace. You're given a pass. You're given an equality slip. You're giving a document. You're giving a ticket that says all that you have done before you call on Jesus can be forgiven, can be erased. You don't earn this. You can't work for it. It is free. It is a gift from God. And it is your opportunity to rise up and say, oh, I thank God that my past is past. I thank God that my sins are forgiven. I thank God that I don't have to do anything in order to get them except Christ as my Lord and Savior. He has given us all grace, given unto every one of us, grace according to the measure of Christ. Christ himself decides what to get according to the measure of the gift. The gift that you have, honor it. What you have from the Lord, treasure it. Don't try to be something you're not. I'm going to talk tonight about the gifts. Don't try to be something you're not, but be who you are because it came from Christ. Whatever yours is, whatever grace that came from God, and you know it's grace because you couldn't have done it yourself. You couldn't have produced it yourself. You could not have manufactured it yourself. It was not able to be bought in a store. Can't order from Amazon or Walmart. It came from Christ, and it is a gift. And Paul teaches here and lets us all to know that this gift is the work of the Lord. Now that you know what you have, you got gifts. He gave gifts unto men. When he rose up from the dead, he went down and descended first into the lower parts and then went on up into heaven. And when he went into heaven, he came back with something. and gave gifts unto men. So when you get into verse 11, where we talk about the pastors, the prophets, the teachers, and all of those things that we count as the five works of grace that are given to the church to save those to the utmost, you have to fully understand why these gifts were given. They were given because Christ, when he went to heaven, presented himself to the Father, he came back and giving you something. And I am going to give each and every one of you who love me, love my name, love my Father, accept my faith, I am going to give you grace. And because you have grace, you are saved. It is the grace of the Lord that we are saved. It is through faith that we have accepted the grace. And because we have faith in Jesus, the blessings and promises of the Lord are now ours. So, did some things that he might fill all things. That is what the word of the Lord says in verse 10, that he might fill all things. So wherever there was a gap in your life, he has something to fill it. Wherever there's a deficit in your life, he has something to fill it. Whatever is missing in you and frustrates you and gets you to the point of feeling like giving up, God has something, and it's a gift from the Lord designed to fill that void, emptiness, and cause you to experience the fullness of the glory of God. Somebody say the fullness of God. The fullness of God comes because of the gift that Jesus gave, and his purpose in giving the gifts was that he might fill all things. So here's what he did. Verse 11, he gave some apostles. Thank God for the apostles. And today, people say, I know there are only 12 apostles. There are only 13 apostles, the one they voted in. But you know, let's think about what we're saying. There were 12 that were chosen by the Lord. He said, I kept them all except one, Judas. Judas, the apostle, was the one. He was numbered with the apostles. Don't forget, Judas was numbered with the apostles, but he fell from grace, even though it was predestined that he should. And he had a pathway to righteousness. There was even grace for Judas. There was even grace for Judas. I know, say, well, nope. He denied God. He betrayed him. And now he's turned over to hell. But you forget that as soon as Jesus died, he went down into hell and preached. He preached captivity to the captive and released them, told them you can be free. Now, if you were Judas and you had just betrayed Jesus and now you're in hell and the same Jesus shows up, is it likely that you would say, nah, I pass. I'll just stay here in hell. I know you're Jesus because I remember you. You know, I worked with you, but I betrayed you. So no, just leave. I'm just telling you, some of y'all are going to be disappointed and probably asked to be sent to the other place if you get to heaven and see Judas, because we have bashed Judas, talked about Judas, mistreated Judas. But honestly, if you think about it, Judas had a work to do. And it took Satan entering into him for that work to be fulfilled. I believe that if Satan had not entered into Judas, he would have gone back on that agreement to betray Christ. But it was necessary. Somebody say it was necessary. And so Judas was named with the apostles, and Jesus prayed in Saint Book of St. John, said, I've kept them all, saving the one who was lost. But Jesus had a plan. He even had grace for Judas. He gave Judas the go-ahead. What you do, do quickly. Go ahead and do it. And Judas, following his assignment, betrayed the Christ. Christ died on the cross and went down into hell and preached to those who were in bondage. And you know that when the earth shook and when the bondage was released, some of those very saints came up out of the grave and walked the earth, the scripture says. It doesn't tell us when they died again or where they went. After they walked, they may still be walking the earth. Y'all better be careful who you treat around here. You may be dealing with angels and saints of the past who have risen from the grave. But now Judas was among the apostles. But now, because he is absent from them, and now they are waiting on the promise of the Lord in the upper room with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and all of the disciples, now about 120, they took care of some business. They elected a replacement for Judas. They had two names and they voted. And they voted in a man named Matthias to fulfill Judas's seat. So you had Judas the apostle, and you had the 11, and now you add Matthias, and then comes another apostle. Paul himself says, am I not worthy to be counted as an apostle? Don't I have the grace to be an apostle? Do you not identify my gift as apostolic, Paul said? You should, because I had a calling from the Lord and experience with the Lord. He gave me an assignment, and my assignment is to win men and women to Christ, and I will win them. And he gave me an establishment spirit. And as an apostle, I establish, I organize, I orchestrate. I not only win souls to Christ, I set up systems of salvation. That's what the apostles do. The apostles erect systems of salvation. And I know people today criticize those that go by the title of apostle, but there are some true apostles. There are some true organizers and establishmentarians that, based on the gospel of Jesus Christ and the instruction given to us by this same Paul, who was numbered with the apostles, some call him the 13th apostle, but in truth, he would be the 14th apostle, am I right? Because you got the 12, which includes Judas, and then you've got Matthias, who was elected in, and now Paul. So I call him the 14th man. But no matter what his number, he was an apostle. And the apostles are gifts to men. The apostles are gifts because their job is to fill all things where the church has a gap. It is the apostles' job to create a ministry and put it in there. And I hear people say all the time, well, I don't believe in bishops. I don't see bishops in the Bible. I don't believe in district superintendents. Where's district superintendents in the Bible? I don't believe in that. And they got so many rules. Why are there reverends? And who said they could be an elder? And where did this regional title come from? An overseer. You know, the problem is you're looking for the completion in the letter. But what the letter here tells us is that Jesus came and gave grace and gifts to all men. Why? That he might fill all things. And those things that he gave, apostles was one of them, he gave them the authority to fill. So what did they do? Because the word told us that the government will be upon Jesus' shoulders. The government, the organization of the work, organization of the church that he told Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. He didn't build us. A really shabby organization. He didn't build a structure that would rise and fall, but he built a church to last forever. And so he...
Well, God bless you. I'm back. Looks like we lost our signal and we're disconnected. But I want you to know the word of God continues. We're talking about the gifts. And if you're able to tune in, if you're able to come back to this, that will be fine. And I believe this word is still intended for somebody to understand the gift and calling of God. So I've talked about the apostles and the necessity of the apostles, who are establishmentarians, who have an assignment to fill in all the necessary ministries of the administration of Jesus, of the work of God in the church. Amen. And somebody send me a text. Let me know you got me back. Hallelujah. Let me know. Let me know that you're back. Praise God. You that have my personal cell phone. I'm not telling my number on the air, but you that have it, send me a message. Let me know that you see me and that I am on. Yes. So what we are dealing with is there are apostles and then there are prophets. And the prophets are special gifts to the body of Christ. They're given an assignment, they're given a work, and everybody can't be a prophet. Everybody can't work in the prophecy. Why? Because prophets have to have a special life of consecration. In order to fulfill your gift, it's like any other vocation. You have to specialize. Did you not know there are specialties in the gift and work of God? You have to specialize in your spiritual calling. You have to be a good prophet. You have to focus on prophecy. Focus on hearing from God. Focus on how to tell the people of God what the Lord is saying. Focus on the best way to deliver it, the most effective way to deliver the word of God. And God has given prophets, God has given teachers, God has given evangelists, An evangelist is a unique role, a unique assignment. Everybody can't be an evangelist. It's not called for everybody. But you need the evangelist because they are there, according to the word of the Lord, to fill in all things, to fill all things. When you read that in verse 10 of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 10, he that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And Jesus is filling the cabinet of his church. He's filling the assignments and the ministry assignments of his church. He's filling all of these gaps and vacancies so that the church can be perfect, so that the church can be mature, and that it could be the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, meaning that the church can rise up to be the kind of church that Jesus died to establish. It is not going to be measured against men. It's going to be measured against Jesus Christ himself. So Jesus is going to keep on working his church and keep on authorizing leadership and authorizing vision and authorizing new programs and new titles and new dimensions in the church. Why? Because he's trying to shape the church to be in the fullness of Christ. He wants the church to be the one that he's died for. In fact, in the end story, we know that he's coming for a church without spot or wrinkle, not even a blemish or any such thing. So you know the church needs some work. That's why Jesus gave apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers. Now, years ago, school was in a one-room schoolhouse, one teacher teaching all subjects. The teacher had to teach everything. The teacher had to teach everybody all subjects. But as knowledge grew, they had to spread out and began to specialize. Now you got math teachers, geometry teachers, phys ed teachers, you got history teachers and science teachers, and even beyond the sciences, the biology and the anthropology. Why? Because they're trying to fill in these gaps of knowledge so that you will have a full understanding of what God is calling for, what God is able to do, and what God is able to cause to make you full, make you mature and perfect. So he gives specialists in the church. The apostle is a specialist. That's a special anointing, a special assignment. And the prophets are specialists. They have a special work and a special gift. They're not ordinary men and women. They don't live lives like ordinary people. They don't do all the things ordinary. They are usually a bit peculiar, somewhat odd, if you will. They're hearing things when you hear nothing, seeing things when you see nothing. And in the midst of a conversation, they can just interrupt you and say, hey, let me tell you what I heard God say. Oh, I felt an anointing from God. God is getting ready to do something. What is it? I can't tell you now. Prophets have a specialty that everybody doesn't have. And then he gave some evangelists. The evangelist has the gift, the power, the authority, and an anointing to be able to come in and to restore those who have fallen from grace, to come in and to preach. And although you've been preached many, many times by your pastor, pastors don't have to be jealous of evangelists. That's their gift. That's the grace of God in them to the body of Christ to fill in that gap. Because I'll tell you, I love being a pastor, but pastors get tired. I love having to tell you the same thing over and over again, but I would like to see some fruit come from it. But look like the evangelist could come in a new way, in a fresh way, and tell you the same thing, preach the same verse, and look like new fire fall in the church. It'll burn for a while, and I'll just keep on preaching, keep on pastoring, dealing with the issues of the pastor, the issues of the building, the issues of the ministry, the one-on-one, the babies and the sickness, hospitalization, crises. The evangelist doesn't have to deal with that. They just got to stay focused on God. The Lord, wherever you send me, I can bring down the fire from heaven, consume the destruction that's trying to destroy your people. And then they could feel your glory once again, be renewed in strength, bring a revival into the church. Thank God for the specialists called the evangelists. These, when Jesus ascended up to heaven, he brought gifts, gave all men grace, but he gave some to be evangelists. And then my territory, pastor and teacher. I love being a pastor and teacher. I think I do a good job being a pastor and teacher. I prophesy sometimes, but I'm not a prophet. I have an apostolic anointing that has done some good work, but I'm not called to be an apostle. I may have an evangelistic fervor and sometimes called to evangelize. That's okay, but I truly am not an evangelist. That is not my calling. That is not my assignment, but I love being a pastor. I love dealing with the people and hearing them, because he calls people. In effect, the word says that he brings us in Hebrew 5. He calls and seeks out from among men people who can be raised up to be pastors and teachers and shepherds and priests. Why? Because he calls us from among men, that we can be sensitive to what's going on in the ordinary person's life. He uses ordinary people. We are not all that unusual. We have the same issues, the same burdens, the same crises. We have the same problems, but we understand our calling, that no matter what's going on in our life, we got to preach to the church. No matter what's going on in the life of the pastor, we have to deal with what can help the people and what can cause them to grow. The pastor and teacher, that's one assignment. Pastor and teacher, one assignment. Pastor and teacher. Pastor and teacher is a role. It's a gift. It's an anointing from God. I'm not the apostle, not the prophet, and not the evangelist. There are many of those, and they are here to fill the gaps and fill the void, and here to do a great work and a great purpose. But thank God that he gives pastors and teachers. I thank God for our apostolic anointing in the Church of God in Christ that raised me to the level of a superintendent, and from a superintendent to an administrative assistant, and on to become a bishop. I love doing these works, but above all things, I understand the grace of God that's upon me to be a pastor and teacher. And these are there for the perfecting of the saints. They're there to better the church. They're there to make you full, to make you become what you ought to be in God. They're there to help make you better. You need a pastor to make you better and teachers to make you better. You need an evangelist to make you better. You need to hear from a prophet every now and then, and you need the work of the apostle to continue the appointments and to continue the government of the church that is upon the shoulders of the apostles. And they are going to be here. They're going to do the work. They're going to struggle to perfect the church. They're going to struggle to perfect the body of Christ. And we are going to be in these offices until we all come into the unity of the faith, till we all get it together, till we all have the knowledge of God, of the Son of God. And we don't act like children. What did mama say? What did daddy say? What are we supposed to do? We know what to do when they're there, but what do you do when those leaders are absent? Are you able to hold on? Did you hold on through COVID when you couldn't get to church? Or was the church your salvation? Did you feel like you're going to lose your faith and give up on Jesus? That means you were like a child tossed to and fro. You went from one website to another, one Facebook page to another. You can listen and hear anybody you want to hear, but you should have tuned into your pastor and teacher. Your pastor and teacher was the one assigned to give you the word of God. And although there are so many other great teachers and preachers out there, you, the son of God, the daughter of God, should have felt fulfilled, because these offices were placed there for you. Placed there to enhance you and to help you grow, not like a child, but mature like an adult, and where you won't be tossed about, carried away with every wind. New doctrine comes through and you're gone. New faith comes through, you're gone. You have learned enough about Jesus that you ought to be rooted and grounded in the truth, that no matter what storm comes, you ought to be like Psalms 1 that said you'd be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters that will not give its fruit out of season, but you will prosper. And whatever you do, you prosper. Why? Because you understand your calling in God and you understand the work of God. And that we henceforth, I'm going to say henceforth, that means from now on, we're going to have it together. Once all of these officers are in work and every one of these who are the grace and gift of God are doing their assignment, and they are doing what they can to speak the truth and love and to grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. We grow up into Christ. Somebody say we grow up Yes, we got to grow up, and you should be a stronger believer now than you were the day you first got saved. You should have a greater understanding with all that God has given you, pastors and teachers, apostles, prophets, evangelists. You have everything you need. It may be in development, but you ought to grow up with these preachings and these teachings and these instructions in righteousness. You ought to grow up into the man and woman that Christ has called you to be. And we're going to do that. We're going to grow up in him in all things. He is the head. He is Christ. And the gifts, these men and women are gifts. These assignments are gifts. These apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers are gifts. I'm a gift. I know it. I'm not bragging. I'm telling you what the Bible said. I am a gift. My teaching is a gift. You can't afford this. My presence is a gift. I'm a busy guy, and so is your pastor. They have much to do, but they understand their calling. And understanding their calling, we realize that we are gifts to the body of Christ. This teaching comes from the fourth chapter of the book of Ephesians, and we've read unto you fourth chapter. I believe we started with verse 7 down to 14 and 15. And the whole point of this text is to let you know that you're not alone. The church is fully equipped. We may be growing and we may be reestablishing and reorganizing after COVID, but everything we have, Jesus brought it back from heaven and gave these gifts unto men to fill all things. And when I say men, I mean to his children, to men and women, that we may fill all things, and offices may be filled. The government of the church is on his shoulders, but Jesus has put a structure in place. So wherever you are, don't get too bent in shape over titles and instructions and names and assignments that change. They change because they should change with the time. They change to fit their environment. They change to fit the times in which men live when this gospel is preached, so that we can grow up in him and be fully mature and be fully the sons and daughters that the Lord has called us to be. I'm sorry for the interruption in the program. Some of you may have caught this as part two. We continued. We had a systems interruption, but I wanted this word to come forth, because as we talk going forward about these gifts, and we have brought to you some prophets and have more prophets to bring you, and we have brought to you some of the other gifts, the apostles, and I hope to have our chief apostle and other apostles of organizations on, and to talk specifically about their work as an apostle of Jesus Christ. Get off of that concept that there was only 12. You already missed that, because Matthias became 13. Judas never ceased to be an apostle, so that he was of the 12. And then came Matthias, and then came Paul, and then came the one that God led to organize your church and your structure and your organization. So these offices are all going to be here until we all come into the knowledge of Christ, until the word of God is preached everywhere, till the gospel of Jesus Christ has saturated this world and the church is fully established, that Jesus can say, it's now time for me to come and get my harvest. And he sends the angels into the field and to reap that which he has sown. God bless you. This is Bishop Amos Live, and I'm bringing you instructions in righteousness as we talk about the gifts. Amen. And we're going to have apostles, prophets, pastors and teachers and evangelists to come and to discuss their assignment in the Lord. As I say, I'm a pastor and a teacher, and I love what I do. Even as a bishop, I'm still a pastor and teacher. That is my primary. That is my unique goal in life, to do my full assignment that Christ has given me. What is your assignment? If you don't know, I'm going to pray with you that the Lord will speak to your heart, and you can talk with your spiritual leader at your church and find out where you should be and what you should be doing in him. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the scriptures and how they have been unfolded unto us. We thank you for increased understanding and increased knowledge concerning the gifts that you have given to the church, and that you've given everybody something. Even if I'm not a prophet, you have given me grace. Even if I'm not an evangelist and an apostle, you've given me grace. Even if I'm not a pastor or a teacher, you have given me grace. And thank you for the grace. Hallelujah. Thank you for the grace by which I am saved that keeps me from day to day. Hallelujah. And we thank you that you have given us all things we need to fill the government of your church, that when you come, you might find a mature people, a mature church, that we have grown up in you to the fullness of the stature of Christ. And we are the church that you're looking for, the church of Jesus Christ. And we give you praise and we give you honor and we glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Continue to pray and seek God's will for your life. Continue to ask God what he would have you to do. Continue to ask God what work he would have you to fulfill. But whatever your assignment in the church, David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to lose my anointing. Let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. Don't let me lose my anointing. And your assignment is where your anointing is. And so if your grace is simply to come and encourage people on your pew, you follow that anointing. If your grace is not gifts of healing, gift of miracles, but I'm talking about an apostle. If you have the grace to be a prophet, the grace to be an evangelist, a pastor, or teacher, then you should fulfill your assignment and watch God do his great work in you. Somebody give God a praise right there, wherever you are. Thank God for the gifts. And I pray that this word has blessed somebody and is blessing you even now. I ask you to support our church, support this ministry, support Bishop Amos Live with your tithe and your offering. Everyone that can, give something. Give something. This is for Old Landmark. This is our Sunday night service. This is it. Hallelujah. And you were accustomed to coming, but now you don't have to come out physically, but you can tune in and make it on your time, what is convenient for you. Isn't that a blessing? Church at your disposal. What a blessing. What a day in which to live. The gospel at your disposal. Gospel when you want it, when you need it. Hallelujah. And you can get it. But I ask you to support it with your tithe and offering. You know how to give by way of Cash App, Old Landmark, OldLandmark, or you may give by way of the Givelify app, www.givelify.com. God bless you. Would you begin giving? Amen. We will praise God for you even now. Alexa, resume. We praise God for his, we praise God for his blessing. We praise God for his anointing. This is a new day. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Amen. Make your election sure. Know that God has called you. Know that he has assigned you for this day. Know that he has assigned you for this work. God bless you. We look to see you on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Don't defer. Be here with us on 7 o'clock Wednesday night, and let's hear the conclusion of the matter. God bless you. We look to see you there. So